SpeedGrader. Anybody else use it a different way or different access points? It's really handy. I mean, that's the good thing, I think.
Is there anything where it automatically puts in comments?
Not comments, but you can apply the same grade to everybody. So let's say, but not the comments, I don't believe. Has anybody else found that? Yeah.
But I'm going to say, I mean, rubrics is essentially that, right? Where if you have a rubric and attach a rubric, then those comments, you can very quickly, just at a click of a button, leave preloaded comments for the students.
That is true. I did come across that one time. I started typing, I think, or it popped up. And you could just click down that prior comment and it inserted it in that box. That rubric.
I noticed for the rubric, it stayed in that small space where in Learning UW it pops open a new window. Did you have like any extensive rubrics? I mean, some of our rubrics are five or six columns.
I think I'm one of the few people on our faculty who even use the rubrics if they're going to use them. So they're used relatively consistently, and they're pretty brief.
I believe you can expand that so that it takes it more of the screen.
But then it was within the student.
Well, then you make the,
right, there was
the preview
a,
smaller as
gotcha.
Well. If you need a big screen and then another screen.
Yeah. It's no big deal. I just noticed.
Okay,
I just noticed that it's different, that it, you know, usually it pops up and just kind of floats over the top, so you can kind of move it around.
I've not ever tried it, but Miguel Garcia Gonzalez uses the iPad grading thing, and he's uses that small screen. And he has pretty extensive rubrics, so I wonder if it's different on the app than it is in the desktop.
Okay.
He loves the little iPad app for the for grading.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it is. I mean, this is something I think that is a plus from our UW. I don't know what you guys all think, too, but it's just more efficient. Before, when we had documentation notes, because there was two instructors, we've had to divide them. And in order to do that, we had to download them. And then we had to reorganize it because they didn't download alphabetically necessarily. We tried to split them so people got different perspectives on the documentation. And then we'd forget who had who, and then we probably just did the same thing as we did last time, and then we had to upload them after comments. So this is, you just go through, alphabetize, you know, flip it, and you're done. So this is, I think, a perk of Canvas.
I think the other thing that's really nice on that front, if you go back to where you were in the grades. So when you do that drop-down thing where you can see everyone's name,
mm-hmm.
if you're in a specific assignment.
Oh, an assignment, you want to go, okay.
Yeah, just any, you can just click on the assignment, right? That column?
The grade book.
In the grade book.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, two. So here, you want a question?
Yeah, so if you click on something, like the one you just had the test you did.
Okay. SpeedGrader?
Yeah.
And there's another one to access SpeedGrader. We went to the assignment directly, not to the home page. So you get grades, the assignment directly, and the home page. Okay.
So if you do the drop down, the little triangle, yeah. So if the test student has been graded, so the next person there has been graded, it's got the green check mark, but the person above has not. They haven't submitted anything.
Right.
So it's really handy. I have a TA kind of the same idea. So with my class with 74 people, I start at the bottom, she starts at the top. But if she gets to one where, like for example, it's a case study and she just doesn't know, there's some questions and I need to go look at it, it has it kind of in between the two. So it has that yellow dot kind of like the test student there. So it looks like that if the person has submitted something but it hasn't been graded, and then it gets a check mark when they're done. So it's an easy way to communicate that either, you know, there's, for some reason that one hasn't been done, and I can click on it and see where the TA is at, or if I'm just grading until I'm exhausted, I know exactly where to pick back up because you've got your checklist right there.
That's
so
nice.
Yeah, that's been handy too.
Exhaustion grading.
I think communication tool.
The scores.
Yeah.
So have you ever left a video recording comments or audio or anything like that? No,
we have not. We have, Colleen doesn't have a camera and I have a camera, but oftentimes people are borrowing it, so they find the camera. It's more a logistical thing than the inability to do it per se, but no, we have not. Has anybody else tried that? Posting camera comments? No.
I tape myself.
I don't think my students cared. I had a real small group, and they were just glad they got comments back.
Yeah, well, and sometimes I think that might be easier if I just could get the logistics down, like have a camera or use my laptop that has a camera. Because with my vision sometimes, depending on how big or little the screen is that I'm working on, it takes me longer to type something that's error-free than it probably would to say it and upload it. So it's a nice tool probably for efficiency again, and it's probably more personal.
Well, certainly for an online class where you don't have a lot of face-to-face time with your instructor, that would add to the instructor presence, have an actual audible voice feedback. All right, we have an activity sheet for you to play around in, and we'll turn on the lights for this so you can get in. You all should have access to the Active Teaching Lab Canvas course. If you haven't already checked your email, you should have an email for it. And we have some rubrics there, I believe, and we have some assignments for you to grade if you want to do the SpeedGrader, and I'll actually get up there and up here and plug in. And we can answer that question of what does it look like from the students? Because I'm kind of curious about that.
So it's the one that's near the bottom, big course design assignment. There are 13 different ones so that each person can grade one. It's just got a really simple rubric attached.
So and the reason we have 13 of them is because you only have one test student. So you'd have to go in and ask, because you guys are all instructors, because you get to grade, but we have, even though there are three instructors or whatever, we still only have one test student. And that one test student can't submit more than one assignment per assignment, submission per assignment. So we've got 13, and everyone has one assignment submitted by the test student. So.
Can I see that up there?
Yeah, you should.
That somebody else taking number one? I got number one. All right. All right, this is the assignment, right?
Right.
All right, so I can look at the rubric for it. And here's where we can change the size of the rubric. So this was sent in as a text box assignment then? All right, so I can see five areas. Is it on the right track? It's off base. Like, it's nothing to do. Something tracks. And what a thoughtful sure. So I can do 5 points out of 10. I can add more comments here. Allow flashing, allow my microphone. And I really like what you did here with the five steps, but nothing to do with tracks, so you're on the wrong track. So dump that. Did I save it? I did not save it.
Forget the title.
Title, job response. Nice job. Click to stop recording.
Save.
Save and recording. Awesome. Oh, you could also upload media. So if you have canned responses, next time you go on the Eiffel Tower is like, ah, very good.
Right.
All right, so I'm curious now. I'm going to hit save, submit. Maybe let's save this as well. Save, submit. Good.
Wait, did you submit?
I did. I hit save. And well, that was for the comments, though.
Yeah.
All right, the comment has been submitted. So now I'm going to go back to the whole course. And look at test student. There's test student. Sample discussion in 08. Big course design assignment number one. All right, so I'm a student now. Well, yeah, I'm not a student. I got to go go to student view. Yes, thank you. Miguel mentioned that it was hard for the students to see what the rubrics showed. Thank you. Can't talk and think of anything.
Yeah.
All right, so now I go to people, I guess.
Go to assignments.
I go to assignments.
You're a student now.
I'm a student now.
It's weird.
Good. I didn't know in this
room. Huh, I'm surprised that doesn't show, like, I guess it shows right there, 5 out of 10.
All right, so. Assignment, SpeedGrader, code points. This is just the assignment. I need to check out my evaluation. All right, so rubric is right there. I'm not on the right track, so, but I did a thorough.
And then you've got a little comment bubble there, too. See that?
Oh, this one right here. It's green, so I can do that. So. Okay, but it's not, it doesn't jump out at me. And then, so that's all I really see. So I don't see the video right now unless I click on Hide Rubric. And then I can see there's a media comment, nice.
That would be you as a student commenting back.
Right.
Right?
So you want to play your picture up there for your
next job.
All right. This doesn't fix the water breaks. Am I creating
it? You can upload it?
Oh, I can't do Crocodoc because it's not a because it's a text file thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Any other experiences that you've had as a SpeedGrader, questions, things you want to dig into?
The OCD in me has to ask, what's up with the lines on the rubric?
Oh.
Were they not? Yeah. I can't stand that. What?
They're
weird. And I even tried in Chrome, they're still like that.
Right.
Because on the right track is just a few words, and you think more about the student's perspective as many words.
No, before you even put anything in there. Oh, you're saying, oh, what you put in there when you're developing the rubric?
I think it adjusts it according to the size of the text in there automatically so that you don't have, like, you know, really long.
So when you're developing the rubric.
Maybe.
That's what sets the
Maybe go look at this.
Column width.
If the OCD is an issue, you'll have to figure out exactly how many letters.
I can't stand it. I know. It's crazy. It's
the inflection rubric, go down there. I just picked one that's template.
Yeah, see, it's yeah, often here as well.
Yeah, but it is. Whoever made that.
I did try that, and it will let you move them, but they don't ever line up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is weird. I've noticed that too.
You just have to program all of your responses.
Yeah, right?
Exactly.
Right.
So I have a question. I don't know if Gil had an answer, but chemistry's been using Canvas in one of their courses, and they've had issues with the roles, and the TA roles have been too empowered.
Oh, interesting.
And they've been doing things that, like, accidentally unpublishing a whole course. Things like that that have been a little problematic, right? So once something is graded, thinking of all these different TAs coming in and grading just their section, are there any mechanisms to keep a little bit more control of it? Like if you're a TA, this is just your section, and once you grade it, somebody can't come in after you, or
I think one thing is, are they TAs or are they graders? I believe, like, TA might have, well,
apparently they set those roles and then they reset every night back to instructor.
Oh.
Or they reset to teacher. They reset to something that's way more powerful. So they set them and then it automatically resets on its own.
Are they instructors of record?
This is something you should know about.
If they're instructors of record, I think sometimes it resets them, but I don't know.
Well, they are, because of the way the course is structured, they do have a presence in faculty centers, so they may be considered an instructor.
I bet you.
Yeah. We had a discussion about this in the instructional technology for Canvas, where in engineering, they only want to give them grading access, but in a lot of letters and sciences courses, the TA is the lecturer, is the course owner.
Right.
And so what automatically populates is set up at the registrar's office.
Okay.
And in D2L, you could go in later on and make those adjustments. And I thought that you could do that in Canvas as well, and people were complaining that, oh, I don't have to readjust it. But you're saying that if they readjust it, it readjusts them back, which is a problem, I think.
Yeah, but I think that's being addressed. I guess my question is, are there ways for a very large lecture that has independent discussion sections, are there ways for TAs to pull just their students out and just do that amount of grading? Because there is a certain amount of things that they need to be able to do,
right?
But it's not fully, and it doesn't apply to all the students in the course.
Right. I don't think that there is a way that I'm aware of. Senator Chris, if you remember anything, correct me.
Because like in D2L, you can get a group. You can get the section within, because there's the lecture section and there's a discussion class, so you can just pull up your discussion section.
Right. There's things you can do with sections and groups, but I don't remember offhand, or I don't think I ever looked into the kind of rights that you might give to a TA with respect to a section or group. I haven't come across that yet.
And in terms of the speed grading group, though, like in terms of the speed grader, are you able to pull out just a small subsection of students, or are all 350 students going to be coming up and the TA has to find theirs? Because the homework system is that way, and it's very cumbersome.
Yeah. Let me see if I can look that up really quick.
It does let you change sections, but I don't know if it will let you then only see this section. I don't think it does.
Yeah. Well, it, as long as it pulls out just a section and a TA knows to go to that section and they have the ability to go to them, that's not a huge issue. But if they have to go through all 350 to find their one.
Yeah.
You know, there is a way to do a group. I don't know if there's in assignments, when you're developing your assignment, there's a tab that says assignment group.
Okay.
So you can, so you're in assignments, and then it will say new group. So you could, it looks like you could group them.
So you have the John Martin group, and then everybody who submits to the John Martin group, John Martin is the TA, and assigns grades to that.
Do you know if those groups are transferable from assignment to assignment? Like if you go there and say,
oh,
one in a course?
That I don't know. So it looks like.
Stop asking hard questions.
So it looks like assignments, and then I can put it in groups. Maybe once you enter one group, it pulls up.
Okay.
Prior ones?
You can totally transfer one group
to that. Okay.
So we have pods in our course, and each pod can do the assignment. But I think if everyone is doing assignment one, and that's the title, then everybody still shows up to grade. When I go through a grade, I don't know what pod they're in.
Okay. And then, like, so I guess my question is, can you filter for a particular pod?
I think you would have to give it a different, it would have to be assignment one, pod one.
Mm-hmm.
And then it would show up as just them having submitted that one, and assignment one, pod two would show up as just them submitting that one. But we had a hard time with that one because then you have, your grade book gets weird, right? If it's a 10-point assignment, you've now assigned that to 10 groups. Mm-hmm. So everyone's going to be, even if everybody gets a perfect score on it, you're going to only have 10% of the grade.
Mm-hmm.
We had sort of the same thing, but in the end, I'm the instructor problem, so it didn't matter as much.
Yeah.
The group thing definitely works, and the groups definitely carry between assignments. So that's for sure.
Okay.
Good questions, really.
Yeah, there's
they're hard questions, so I don't like them. But.
Well, so what we're kind of the eyes towards is they have their lab reports that they turn in, and right now it's still paper, but they want to make it a lot more efficient.
Sure.
And so there's conversations going on right now about what we can do to make grading more efficient.
Oh yeah.
So?
Well, as Google Doc templates, for example, you can have a Google Doc template that has all of the different parts of the lab.
Right, and that's what Rachel's actually, you know, Rachel Bain, she's actually working on that right now.
Groups.
And
I have a major over here.
Yeah, so she's working on that, and then also trying to match a Google sheet to the back of it, so that, but the thing is a lot of them are stable tables, and
yeah.
Form is linear. So we're trying to figure out a way to make a two-dimensional piece.
Awesome. Let John know when you have that worked out.
Right. Yeah.
All right. You guys are down for October 3rd.
So here's one thing I'm noticing. Look at this. In the grades area, it's default to showing all sections. So if students were enrolled in different sections, maybe that would be a way.
Okay.
But no, I was thinking of that, but is each of your sections like 300 people? Like my section is 40, you know, but
so
you're.
So each student, when they sign up for a lecture section, which can take up to 350 students, but then they're part of a smaller discussion lab section, which is 22 students.
Yeah.
And a TA is assigned to each of those. And a TA usually has anywhere from one to three of those sections. So a TA will need to go through and pull out this 20 group of 22, the next group of 22, and the next group of 22. And the online homework system we use is outside of LearnUW, it's kept with the textbook, and there is no way to put the section in. So anytime I need to go through and look for a particular student, it's going alphabetically to 350 students. I just see a lot of potential confusion if there's 16 TAs assigned to the course, and especially when they're getting to know their students, some names may look similar.
Right. And they're not chunked up like A through G and G.
Oh no. That would be too nice.
Right.
Now, and that's the it's all about their schedule. It's okay. Their section. That's their schedule. And even if they did know their students, that adds an enormous amount of efficiency to have to make sure you're on the record instead of just next record.
Well, the risk of error, as you said, goes up.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I'm still hopeful we will find a solution.
We are finding lots. I think the longer that we're playing around on campus, the more we're finding that it's little bit in dark corners of it. Inconsistencies and issues and problems. And what looked like a really awesome, strong learning management system is turning into another learning management system with all of its lovely parts and less lovely parts.
Mm-hmm. So the Google Form idea, there is not a two-dimensional way to enter data or take
not form. For Google Form, no. If you create a
could you create a Google Sheet like you would maybe in Excel, where you've got like it's the front, it's the where you just have you tell the students they need to enter it in, and then it automatically feeds it. Can you block down a Google Sheet like you can in Excel?
So, well, what you can do is with the Google Apps integration, I've not tried this, but this is the way I understand it. If you create something and you put a link to it there of the Google Sheet, whenever the student comes in and clicks on that link, whatever you created is copied to theirs. So if you have all of the tables and forms and headings and rows and whatever set up and the calculation things set up, as they add the pieces, whatever graphs you've already created with linked data should show up with their data on it. So all of those things should be happening on their own version.
Okay. Okay.
I've not tried this yet, so I don't know.
Okay.
But I think also because you have the original, you have access to it, and I don't think they have to then re-upload it. I think that you are already in order of it, but it's shared with them on and moved over to their document, I think.
Okay. And then there's the open response question there, which the SpeedGrader will work right at. That part's easy.
One of 20.
Right, one.
One of the cons.
Yeah, but it would be really nice to have the rubrics.
Yeah. The interface between everything.
Right.
How many of you have used rubrics for several things? Are comfortable using rubrics?
Just like old-fashioned paper rubrics?
Okay, sure. And in SpeedGrader rubrics, anyone? I have not used it for any classes, but just for the act of teaching, it's
neat.
I mean, it offers you some quick stuff.
But you know what I find interesting? It seems like you used to write, a course description of each assignment description, and then the objectives of that assignment. And then students still were like, well, I don't know, what do you want us to do? And I'm like, look on page 5 of the syllabus, it's da-da-da-da. So this year, I pulled like brief things out and put it in the assignment opening page for each assignment. And then, like this one, I made a rubric of kind of my test assignment, just to see if they still ask me questions. Because now it's very explicit, not only one place, but three. You know, and I think the only challenge to that I find is, I don't know if you guys can leave things alone. Like, once you get it on paper, like, ooh, I just want to just change this little thing. And now you have three places to change that little thing. So, you know, I think the moral of that story is don't do Canvas until you've really firmed up what you really want that to look like, because you will become inefficient again.
This is not the official position of the UW Madison, by the way.
I think that has seemed to help so far. I get less questions about expectations.
One of the things that I've noticed about the rubrics is once you've set a rubric, it doesn't say it here, but once you've set a rubric and you've used it, you can't make any changes. Because the idea is, well, if you've used the rubric and I've already graded Sue's work, then if I go and grade Peter's work, and the rubric's different, it's not good.
Which that kind of makes sense.
But I think you can copy it and then change that one.
For future use in a different,
In the active teaching lab, your grades don't matter, right? So it doesn't.
Right.
I believe you can have it so that it's set up.
I think they can.
I think they see it in assignments when you click.
I think you can, but I
believe that we saw that it's on the very bottom of the assignments page.
Are you asking if students can see it?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it shows.
One of the really great promises of Canvas and the rubrics especially is this idea of outcomes. With the outcomes up there. You can have your learning goals and objectives for the course set up here, and then you can apply those to a rubric so that when you manage the rubrics, and you add a rubric. You can find, there in the very bottom here, you can find outcomes that are related to that. So you can continually remind students that this is one of the objectives of the course, and here it is in assignment 1, and here it is again in assignment 3, and here it is again in assignment 12. So it keeps going back as a way to sort of remind them that, oh yeah, this is why I'm in this course, this is what I'm supposed to be learning. And I think it's a good form of insight. Call it distributed learning. So it's a good way to sort of revisit over and over and over again that this is important. Any other questions for that we may or may not be able to answer?
How did you get to the rubric?
See, this is now a fun, good question.
To create one or to add one?
Okay. There's a couple different ways, I'm guessing.
Or like even to that page right there.
So, where would you guess that rubrics is found on this page? Would you guess that these three dots means rubrics?
Oh my god.
Yeah. I'm
There it is. Manage rubrics. And then you can get rubrics.
Go to assignments. You can also go to your assignment and we'll say add rubric.
Okay.
And you can, it'll pop up.
But like if you want to edit them, you have to go through all the ones, right?
Right.
Okay.
Right. One of those.
But you can only edit it if you haven't graded with it.
Right. For that session.
Right.
So this.
Ooh, look at that disjuncture of lines.
Yeah, the disjuncture of the way. But I do believe if you click on assignments, students can't see the rubric.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I think is the hardest part with Canvas sometimes, there's so many access points.
Which is, in some ways, you know, different learners have different interests and different ways that they will logically move through stuff. But at the same time, if I see five different ways, well, that's okay.
Well, I think you had mentioned that to me, like how do we as instructors guide students to the most simplistic path to get where we want them to go?
But what's most simplistic for us, obviously, you go this way, some students don't get it. So it's that balance between universal design and principles of multiple forms of whatever versus this is the easiest one, I think. Or this is the one that aligns with professional practice in our discipline, which is the one you should start to learn.
Right.
When you hide files, like you have did, your example that you were giving about files, I find that happening to myself all the time as the instructor in there. Does that happen to students too, if you have it hidden? Can they still get to files?
No, if they're hidden, they can't see them.
Okay, so if they're hidden, then they go to module, and they go to the opening page, and then it's not going to, okay.
No, perfect. Interestingly, Jen's like, oh, you can, like, you know, he has some of those things grayed out.
Yeah.
He's like, well, you can get rid of files. And I was like so excited. So I took the whole thing and just got rid of it. Well, it wiped out all my modules because I couldn't see anything. So you still have to go back and be, you know, specific about which modules you're pulling out of that whole mess. But yeah, if you hide them, they can't see them.
Okay.
If you organize your classes with, you know, this page is for today's class, this other page is for next tomorrow's class, and you have the links throughout, like, here are the learning outcomes for today, here's what I want you to read until the meeting, here's what I want you to watch and embed a video, here's a quiz I want you to do, here's a link to the quiz, you know, here are some files to look at, you embed the files there, you don't have to have them go into this file thing and dig through that mess, because it's all very explicitly organized there.
If you take that files, I guess I was under the assumption, I have it grayed out on the left. Is there another way for them to get to?
They can get to any links that you have from that file. They just can't see the whole big bucket.
Okay.
So they can't go into the room and be like, oh, I want this file, and I want this file, and I want this file. They can only see the one file that you have linked to that each page. So again, it's a way of saying, overwhelming stuff. Okay, no, this is all I have to focus on right now as a student.
I had that issue when I tried to import my website and then just told them to wipe it away and start it over because there was just stuff everywhere.
Yeah,
and modules, same way, right? If I have a list of modules, unless they're very explicitly, very clearly labeled, that can be confusing too. Like, which module am I supposed to do? Are they alphabetical from top to bottom? Do I have to look through all of them to see if there's anything else for February 25th or whatever?
And that's, you know, that's where I think we're learning, like for modules, it's like week one module and the topic. And then we share it to students, go to modules, not files.
Right.
You know, if you get to the files, go back to the modules. So we're learning how to cue students better too, I think, to minimize their frustrations until we figure out how to really integrate the file system and the pages that John was mentioning.
Lots of options. And I don't know if there are best practices. I think that they vary. What works for you and what works for your students. Peter?
Is that muting an assignment, is that the same as hiding?
So muting an assignment is a really cool thing for when you start grading things, because if I've got 100 students in my class and I'm sitting down with my cup of coffee and I start grading through them and they're not muted, as soon as I get that first one graded, Beth gets her grade. As soon as I get the next one, Kristen gets her grade. If I mute them all, I can go through and I can grade them, and about three quarters of the way through, I'll be like, maybe I've been grading them wrong. Then I can go back up and make changes there. If I get halfway through and they're not muted, and something happens, I run out of coffee or something, so I'm like, oh, I'll go back to this tomorrow, Now half your students are graded and half your students are not graded. They start talking to each other like, I got a B, what did you get? Like, I didn't get graded, what's going on? Then you get an email saying, why are you grading me?
So if you're looking to hide the assignment entirely, you would just not publish it yet.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we're about done. If there are any